For the community, by the community, Trans Radio UK.
Did you know we have an active and fun chat room? Come and join presenters and other listeners at transradiouk.com. Truck United FC, the new football team for the LGBT community. Visit TRUKUnitedFC.com for more details. Trans Radio UK, here for the community, 24 hours a day.
It's Wednesday, it's 9 o'clock, and you know the drill by now. It's time for the LGBTQ Plus Late Show with myself, Kevin, here on Trans Radio. I hope everybody's keeping well. Just about everybody I know seems to be down with the sniffles at the moment, and I wish everyone a speedy recovery. It's just this cold that's doing the rounds, which I had a couple of weeks ago when everybody will possibly remember me being very, very husky. But I think because everybody's been locked up for the last year and a half, none of us have any natural immunity. So, as I say, lots of friends are down with this cold or even flus or just the allergy going around. I mean, it's almost December. So that's my big shout out at the top of the show this evening. And get well soon to just about everybody. Well, this evening, we have our regular guests, the fabulous Ruffles. We're going to be finding out what is ruffling her feathers this week. And of course, we're going to cross the Irish Sea to the voice of Ireland, Rory. Rory's just going to talk about some of the events which took place last Saturday for Transgender Day of Remembrance. And it was at the vigil here in Brighton on Sunday when I got to meet my first guest. And she's an award-winning author, mostly young adult fiction and non-fiction. And she also has written books that you may be more than familiar with, including This Book is Gay and What's the Tea? It's best-selling author Juno Dawson, and I welcome Juno along to the show now.
Thank you for having me. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Well, I know we've been talking for a few minutes before we came on air. I didn't put two and two together on Sunday. I asked you to speak on the program because it was I've been to a number of Transgender Day of Remembrance events and vigils over the years. You were an exceptional orator and gave a beautiful and touching talk on Sunday, which is what I wanted to talk to you about. And it was only afterwards that I realized exactly who you were. And one of your books is a staple for a friend of mine who works with an awful lot of who has a non-binary child and who works with a lot of trans and non-binary kids in Ireland. So that was incredibly exciting.
It is I, one in the same.
So I want to talk to you first of all about Sunday and your message on Sunday. And it was incredibly powerful when you spoke about transgender color of people of color, when you spoke about the high incidence within sex workers. It's all facts that are all too familiar to many of our listeners. But perhaps for some of the listeners who aren't familiar, would you mind recapping some of the points that that you made on Sunday?
Yeah, so it's kind of, you know, I'm happy to take part in things like that. But I think it's always really important to be mindful of the fact that I, in so many ways, I'm one of the lucky ones, you know, not as lucky as I could have been, because I could have been born cisgender, but, you know, I'm often invited to speak at things, and I am financially solvent, I'm married, my family were always very supportive of my transition, I can keep a roof over my head, I have a very steady career now. But when you look at those list of names, and this year there were 375 trans people who've died by violence in the last 12 months. When you look at those names, they're mostly in the global south, and they're mostly people of color, particularly trans women of color. And well over half of those people were also sex workers that we know of. You know, that's the 375 people that we know of. So I think if I'm going to stand there on Transgender Day of Remembrance, you know, I think it's really important to recognize that, you know, we're not quite all in the same boat. And it's important to ask big questions about why is more than half of that list sex workers? And why is well more than half of that list people of color? And so I think that's when, you know, there's no point in having a day of remembrance if we're not going to examine why this keeps happening. You know, what is it about the system, about our world, that leaves all trans people vulnerable, but some trans people much more vulnerable than others? And I think it's a responsibility for the whole community to kind of ask those questions and try work out if there's a better way of doing things. If you know, the worst thing is, you know, year on year, every single year, they say, you know, this has been the deadliest year on record for trans people. So, you know, the first goal would be just to get less than 375 people losing their life next year. But, you know, I say, let's really go for it and see if we could eliminate the need to have a transgender day of remembrance.
I think one of the things that really stuck with me this year, and I guess because there wasn't an in-person event last year, and I'm sure I must have seen it before, but when we were at the presentation in the Ledward Centre of Say Their Name, the number of people who it said name unknown, and I think the one that really got me, I mean, it was a hugely emotional day, but when I lost it was name unknown, and it's something that I'm speaking about throughout the show tonight. Name unknown, age 13, Italy, in June of this year, and that was the point where I was gone. For somebody so young to not have their name up there, it truly has. I mean, every year is horrific, but some things just stick out in your mind more than others. Some things really get you right where they shouldn't. And I think, of course, even today, some of the comments I have seen online, some of the hateful comments, and some of the comments made by a group supposedly representing the gay community, who certainly don't represent any gay community I'm part of, by a charity which I refuse to name anymore, but I think you probably know who I'm talking about, and their comments and feedback on the fact that the Brits and the Brit Awards are now moving to non-gender specific awards. Some of the hate comments I've seen online, anybody who thinks that there is any form of equality for the trans community at the moment, I mean, it will be.
Yeah, and I mean, it's like those kind of things, this is why, you know that those organizations aren't advocating for any sort of LGB person, because this is not something that I care about. Like, I'm not seeing, with the exception of one or two trans and non-binary musicians, this is not something that is affecting most trans people. Mm-hmm. This is not something that affects trans sex workers in the global south.
Yeah.
You know, who gives a tiny rat's bottom what category we have at the Brit Awards when we have 375 people a year dying? And this is it. This is a complete distraction. And one of the things I said at the vigil on Sunday is that I think it's so important that we keep stating our aims, you know, which is just swift access to healthcare, swift access to mental health care, legal systems that protect us, streamlined ways for us to legally change our gender so we can be legally protected by the existing laws for trans people, you know, an end to homelessness, more domestic violence shelters for all women, you know, not just trans women, but, you know, they have been cut within an inch of their lives. So, you know, this is nothing personal, but, you know, I'm not going to get drawn into conversations about gender neutral gingerbread people at prayer. Yeah. Because that is not the best use of my time when, you know, we really have a crisis which leaves people dead, kind of.
Absolutely. And I think one of the things that we see in terms of headlines, as you say, we get dragged down into, you know, the media likes to focus on those things, cause division. And I think one of the things that we have seen a lot over the weekend was obviously the 375 people. And it's amazing that there's visibility, that it's disgraceful that we still have that number. But some of the things we don't hear about are the HIV infection rates within some of the trans community and sex workers, particularly in some of the Southern American countries. And those, because we keep hearing noise and people keep bringing things up, like, you know, who gets an award on stage, those figures are just not by and large reported.
No, and I think it's about for too long, maybe we sort of played along with it, with a media narrative. And, you know, I came out in 2014. And since then, I realized people keep asking me the same questions. And maybe for the first 4 years, I answered them because I've been raised to be polite. You know, my mother raised me right. But then I realized, hang on, I've told you this many, many times, and you're still asking the wrong questions. So actually, now, if people aren't going to ask the right questions, I just need to shut those questions down and just say, people are waiting 3 years to be seen by an NHS specialist. With what other sort of complaint would you expect to wait 3.5 years to even be seen by a specialist? And that at the moment is the reality. If I was to come out as trans tomorrow, I would expect to wait 3.5 years to be seen by a specialist doctor.
And that's, again, that's one of the things that over the last couple of years, it's one of the things that I have only become aware of, because I had no idea, living in my little world, that the wait times were so long. And one of my very good friends recently had to pay for his own top surgery. He waited for as many years as he could before he just got to the point where he had to live his life as he could. And I know he did a crowdfunder, but in what world do we live where we have people having to crowdfund for their surgeries because the NHS can't see them?
And it's, you know, it's an endlessly frustrating that that's the way. But it's kind of, you know, the horror of the fact is as well that once your friend would have been seen by a doctor, there's still a gazillion hoops to jump through. And nothing happens fast. And, you know, patients, I always say that, you know, particularly for parents of trans youth, they're always like, what one piece of advice would you give? I'm always like, nothing is a race. You know, it's really tempting once you know your identity is to really sort of throw yourself into it and kind of, you know, tomorrow just can't come soon enough. Because it does. And I think this is true of whether you're L or G or B or T. You know, it's true for all of us, which is that once you've answered that riddle about your identity, you just can't wait. You just want to get started. Oh, that's what it is. Right, let's go. But unfortunately, you know, and so I always say, you know, there are so many things you can do while you're on that wait list. And, you know, even when I started in 2014, it was still like a 10-month wait list kind of. But that they have just gotten worse and worse and worse. And so I think it's about just, if you say them enough, hopefully those people in positions of power will listen. Because do you know what? They could. There is no reason, I can see no reason other than transphobia, why my GP wasn't allowed to start my treatment. My GP was an amazing ally, a gay man in London. He was like, this is ridiculous, because the medication that I take is the same medication that my mum takes to combat the menopause. You know, we're both on HRT. The difference was my mum's GP could just send her home with a prescription. I had to wait 10 months to see a specialist to diagnose me as being transgender. Well, I didn't need a doctor to tell me I was transgender. You know, I decided that for myself. So it's the system that we have 20 years ago was fab, but now it's very out of date. You know, we're lagging. We're well behind places like the Republic of Ireland. We're well behind most of mainland Europe. We're behind many states in the United States as well. So there's a huge precedent for just making the system better. But it's about, we need politicians who are going to find the political will. Because do you know what? There are really easy solutions that would make life so much easier for trans people. It's just, you know, there are organizations like the one you hinted at who are trying to put barricades in the way of progress, you know, and that's endlessly frustrating because, you know, by all means, kind of call me names and, you know, say, gosh, Juno Dawson looks like a man, but don't come after healthcare. Don't go after the charities that support trans people, which is why, you know, in the last couple of years, we've seen a really unhinged attack on Mermaids and then Stonewall. You know, and I cannot, you know, you can predict which ones are going to be next, you know, and similarly attacks on the NHS as well. So it's through legal challenges to the Tavistock Clinic. So it's kind of, it's very unpleasant right now in this country as being trans. I swear I'm about 3 bad headlines away from just throwing the towel in and moving to Galway or something.
So. Yeah. Do you know, one of the things that I found really, really incredible was, I was just taking a look into some pieces. Rory joins me each week from Ireland and will be joining me later on tonight's programme, just as to what's going on within the LGBT community in Ireland. And so when I was kind of looking into what happened in Dublin on Saturday for TDOR and so on, to see the support, the interconnectivity with groups. We had Sex Workers Alliance Ireland. We had Abortion Rights IE. We had all of these amazing organizations all throwing the support behind Saturday and what was happening, and all working in a really interconnected way, and working in an interconnected way to take on the Irish Times, which is currently going unquestioned in publishing articles about conversion therapies. So all of these great organizations are really working as one. And from the Ireland I grew up in, it's lovely to see. Mm. It's lovely to see that everybody, I think that it's greater than the sum of its parts, if that makes sense. And it's lovely to see, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Ireland, as I've said many times, my book's always done really well in Ireland. So there is a definite future where I just quit the UK. I don't know. It's so frustrating. My granddad's father was Irish, which of course that means it's one generation out for me to be able to apply for an Irish passport. So that is one of the great disappointments of my life, that I can't apply for an Irish passport, but never mind. You can't have everything.
Well, there's very few advantages to coming from Northern Ireland, particularly in the era. I'm a heck of a lot older than you are. So particularly in the era that I grew up. But one of the advantages...
I bet I'm not much younger than you. I'm deceptively old. It's all Botox and fillers, Kevin. That's what it is.
Yes, what's my excuse? I have those and they still look old. But one of the great things is that I have dual citizenship. So certainly in this place and time, it's great. I've UK and a European passport, so it makes life all that that easier. But when you were talking about the books, actually, what's the tea? The friend in Ireland who works with a lot of youth groups had mentioned it to me and said it was an incredible book. And this book is gay. I have heard about before, and I mean, presumably they're both doing incredibly. What's the Tea is by far the most recent. It's fairly new. Am I right in saying that?
I've had a novel out since. I've got a Christmas novel out called Stay Another Day, which is, if you've liked my past novels, you would definitely have it. It's a Christmas rom-com in a novel. So if you like films like Happiest Season and The Family Stone, it's another sort of teen love story with loads of queer characters that I think Yeah, I wrote it during lockdown last year, and obviously Christmas was cancelled. So it was kind of like, it was a way for me to have Christmas, given that we didn't really get to do Christmas last year. But yeah, for a lot of people, it's This Book Is Gay and What's the Tea that I think I will be known for. I think, you know, This Book Is Gay, I think it's been translated into about 21 languages now. And, you know, it's currently having a bit of a tough time in America as This Book Is Gay. Lots of states are trying to ban it from school libraries and stuff, which is still really depressing that a book like This Book Is Gay, you know, is still considered controversial. I never particularly thought of it as controversial. And what's the tea? Perhaps, so This Book Is Gay came out 7 years ago now. Mm-hmm. And I think with What's the Tea, we've learned a lot from what has happened with This Book Is Gay. And so we've actually written a slightly more gentle book because we didn't want people to say, we can't have this book in the school library because it has a swear word in. Yeah. So actually it's a very PG rated book, but it's everything you would need to know about being a young trans person or a young non-binary person, even a young questioning person or an ally. And if you are seriously talking about banning What's the Tea, it's because you're a transphobe. It's because you fundamentally don't like the idea that people are trans. So we were very, very careful. There is sex education in it, and that's really important because cis and straight kids get sex education when they're 11 years old. Mm-hmm. And, you know, LGBTQ children don't get appropriate sex education. You know, schools are now allowed to, you know, acknowledge that there are LGBTQ students, but the provision is very patchy. You know, where very often there is an amazing teacher from within the community, they might get PSHE, which is a cut above, but most LGBTQ kids are just told, oh, and they exist too.
Yeah.
Well, what about sex education for queer kids? Because, you know, it's not about how babies are made. Mm-hmm. So if you're in a same-sex couple, you're being told the wrong sex education. And so that's why it was really important for me with those books to say, this is what you've heard at school. Mm-hmm. However, additionally, this is what I wish I'd known when I was 14 years old. And yeah, I wish somebody had told me about condom use and lube and about PrEP and mm-hmm. PEP and access to sexual health clinics. You know, I wish I'd known all those things. I wish somebody had taught me to be confident enough to say to my partners, you know, this is why we always use condoms, or, mm-hmm. you know, undetectable means untransmittable. Mm-hmm. You know, things have changed, and, you know, the young kids, they need to know. They need to know because they're not being told in schools.
And it's quite remarkable that somebody as old as I am feels that, so I didn't know all the details, but in some ways I felt more educated or prepared going into teens because I grew up in the era of AIDS, and AIDS having a 100% death sentence and being 100% terminal, with the iceberg ads and with everything that happened. There was no, kids nowadays, the conversations, from what I have seen, don't appear to be happening. So kids aren't as forearmed to know that, you know, whilst people may not be dying here with AIDS, that kids don't know that HIV is still here. No. It's still around. It's still being transmitted. And it's quite remarkable.
It is. And I think it's genuinely my hope that within the next 10 years, especially in the developed West, that HIV infection just shouldn't be a thing, not with PrEP. And, you know, if I was still single, I've been with my husband for over 3 years, but if I was still single, I know without a shadow of a doubt that I would get myself on PrEP because, you know, accidents happen. And I think we need to be mature about that as well. And as much as we say, kids, you must always use a condom, yeah. I think we also need to be realistic and say, but what have you done? You know, what if something goes wrong?
Yeah.
So I think that's super important. Because you're right, there was a definite, you know, I was so the post-AIDS generation. I grew up in the 90s.
Yeah.
And so I correlated being gay with HIV and AIDS because of what I'd seen in the media. You know, that it wasn't my fault. I was a kid. But it was enough to scare me to death, you know. And when I did start having sexual relationships when I was older, you know, I was really, really fearful. For me, mm-hmm. sex was something that was quite scary. And I think it's not a bad thing that queer people learned not to be scared of sex, because yeah. I don't think people should be scared of sex. However, there was, you know, there was a slightly worrying moment within the last decade where HIV rates started to climb again after a decline. And actually the increase in rates were very often with young gay and bisexual men and young trans people.
Yeah.
But I'm really, really hoping that, you know, PrEP has been rolled out now. If you are in one of those at-risk groups, if you're a gay or bi man, if you're a trans woman or indeed a trans man who has sex with men, then you are, I think, eligible for PrEP. And I think you can get it through your sexual health clinic. And you take one pill a day.
Yeah.
And it technically means, again, if you're under, you know, but the things that we know, like now, if people who are HIV positive are taking their medication, they just cannot pass on HIV.
Absolutely.
You know, science has changed the conversation we need to have about HIV. And actually, so I wrote, this book is gay in 2012.
Mm-hmm.
We have since had to rewrite sections of it twice, once in 2016 and once in 2019, mm-hmm. to reflect these advances with things like U equals U and with PrEP becoming available on the NHS. You know, HIV has changed, and mm-hmm. sex doesn't need to be scary, but we also need to put our faith in science and be smart.
I think one of the things that PrEP has given so much. PrEP has given so much hope. We actually have the show next week is a special on 40 years living with HIV and AIDS, and 40 years mm-hmm. since those first diagnoses came across from the US. So the show is going to be purely focused. It's going to be purely focused on that because, of course, next Wednesday is World AIDS Day.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to have quite a few messages or quite a few. We've got Matthew Hodson from AIDS Map, and we've got we've some wonderful guests lined up, and Bill from the Sussex Beacon. So U equals U is very much so going to be a part of the message that yes. That we deliver next week. Juno, thank you so much for joining me this evening. It's been incredible.
Thank you for having me. What a pleasure. What an absolute pleasure. Yes, thanks.
It's been absolutely wonderful. Thank you so much. So your Christmas book is called...
Stay Another Day.
Stay Another Day. Is it out now or is it out in a few weeks?
It is out now. All
excellent.
Good bookshops.
Fabulous. I hope it's another bestseller for you. Thank you so much for joining
me. Thank you. Good night.
Thanks. Bye.
Oh, I love this.
We continue in moments.
This is good.
Yes, yes.
You're locked to Trans Radio UK. Our truck shop is open. Hoodies, t-shirts, face masks, hats, and a whole lot more. Visit transradiouk.com.
Ever wondered what a rainbow might sound like? Chimes? Harps? How about a chorus of 100 LGBT plus good causes? On the Rainbow Lottery. It only costs £1 to play, and 50p goes to help people living with HIV, safe housing, human rights, pride groups, and many more. And guess what? You could win 25 grand each week. Go on, contribute to our chorus of great causes and win on rainbowlottery.co.uk. Players must be 18 or over. Always play responsibly, you lovely lot.
Finding the right dress size and fit can be impossible. Let Mischief Collections design and create for your new figure, from a simple consultation to a beautiful delivered garment, created just for you. Contact www.mischiefcollections.co.uk for more information.
Looking for business cards, flyers, in fact anything in print? We can help. Digital format specialists, www.printsmart.uk.com. Think smart, print smart.
Hi, I'm Hazel Dean, and you can get my new Always collection from the LGBTQ Plus shop, with all the profits going to Trans Radio UK.
www.thelgbtqshop.com/Hazel. Hazel is spelled with two L's. Hazell.
Trans Radio UK is on.
Right now.
Across the UK and beyond. Now. Now. More of the music you love.
What's more?
Trans Radio UK.
One of the things you will notice about tonight's show is that there is no On the Box with Steve. Sadly, our dear friend Steve, who you will all have heard me having shenanigans with and having a good old chinwag with each week about what's been on the telly or about what movies we've been watching, Steve has actually taken a very fancy new job and had to leave. So, Steve, thank you so much for the last number of weeks. We will miss you on the show, and I will certainly miss your camp shenanigans. But what it does mean is that there's an opportunity for anybody who would like to speak to me about what they're viewing on the box, or indeed their Christmas movies. If you've seen one that you've loved or hated, drop me an email. It's kevin@transradiouk.com. Drop me an email and I would be delighted to have a chat with you and play it on the show. So come along, have a wee chinwag with me. That's kevin@transradiouk.com. Drop me a line and we'll have a chat about what you are watching. Over the next couple of weeks, we do have some amazing guests lined up for you. I'm not going to spoil the surprises. Now that the show's been going for a while, we're getting messages from some wonderful people, and I'm really looking forward to introducing some of them on the show over the next few weeks. But at the minute, we are going to our regular guest. He is the voice of Ireland. We're going to cross the Irish Sea, be it by Ryanair, by ferry, whatever way you want to go. We're going to cross the Irish Sea and say hello to my very dear friend and our voice of Ireland. It is, of course, Rory Carrick.
Good evening, Kevin, and how are you today?
I am not too bad at all. Slightly.
I'm also glad you said dull set rather than dull. I felt like there was a bit of a pregnant pause between dull and set there, you know. Just throwing that out there.
Well, you see, with the pronunciation, one of the things I always found comical when I moved to Dublin 20-odd years ago, whenever it was when everybody talked about Dorset Street. And I'm like, it's Dorset. It's Dorset.
I say Dorset.
Everybody says Dorset in Dublin, but it's spelled D-O-R-S-E-T, and presumably it was named by somebody British back in the days. So it's Dorset Street.
It's Dorset Street. No, it's Dorset Street. Also, what I did notice listening to the show last week, and I'm trying to not do it this week, is when we're chatting, we literally talk 90 to the dozen. It's like, and I forget that's like a lot of Irish people do that. It's literally just flying through, and not everyone can understand and pick up on it. So we might need to go a little slower, even for me.
Well, you know, one of the things I've learned over the years is to try and be comprehensible here and hide my Nadine-type tendencies. When I tell you, what about you? Hi, what's going on? Hi, well, oh dear, where did I put my passport?
Fleur.
Any listener who's listening in now will be very confused if they haven't seen the Nadine Coyle from Girls Aloud Irish shenanigans that she get up to with her passport. But that's a story for another day. Today, I believe that there have been some requests for a rainbow crossing in South County Dublin.
Yes, this is very true. As you know, we have some on the north side. I feel like the north siders are always first to get in there and make the change that actually matters. South County Dublin, one of their councillors over there has put in requests to have a rainbow walkway put in. So they, Councillor Francis Timmins. Now they haven't yet decided where exactly it's going to be. Hopefully it will be somewhere prominent. And obviously, of course, the message behind these is a symbol of equality and diversity and inclusion. And I think a lot of people, if you're not part of the community as we are, don't necessarily understand the significance of it and kind of think, what is the point of putting a rainbow walkway there? But it just means so much more than just colours on a path.
I think that's certainly the feedback that I have seen from across the UK, where there were quite a number of them put up over the last few years. And we recently had our first trans-coloured crossing. And it's incredible to see. And you see it from the likes and shares and so many people saying this is a great sign of visibility, especially in areas where perhaps visibility wouldn't have been the highest. Places like Surrey got a rainbow walkway in, I think it was during the summer. And, you know, places where there wouldn't be a huge element of visibility, especially for younger people who are struggling to come out or who have just come out, it's a very visible reaffirmation.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just think the more kind of acceptance cues that we can give people, you know, whether that be as simple as something as simple as painting a walkway, then the better. I wasn't aware that there were trans colored ones in the UK, which is marvelous. And again, I'd love to see something like that here in Ireland.
Just one. We had the first one, but they're just a great way to reaffirm visibility. And this week we've spoken about it a few times on the show tonight. This week, of course, we're not very long after Trans Day of Remembrance, which took place on Saturday. I believe that there were vigils and there was visibility in Dublin over the weekend.
Yeah, absolutely. So November 20th, Transgender Equality Remembrance Day. It was fairly big turnout around the city. It's obviously always great to see. I was looking at the Twitter account for Transgender Equality Network Ireland, which were recording figures from October 20th to September 21st. And the figures are actually startling. So they had a record of 375 trans and gender diverse people reported murdered. And I know you spoke a little bit about this last week as well. But the figure that really kind of rocked me, and I thought, wow, the youngest was 13.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 13 years of age. Absolutely incredible. And 89% of those killed in the USA were people of color.
Yeah.
And the majority of the people who had listed an occupation or had an occupation listed against them were trans sex workers.
I was able to hold it together. We had quite a big vigil here in Brighton, not on the day, it was the following day, it was on Sunday. And after the vigil, and we had some fantastic trans speakers and non-binary speakers. And afterwards, it was the video, Say Their Name, the video which slowly played with the name of everybody who had been killed. And it's funny that you coincidentally mentioned the 13-year-old. That's the one that got me, because it came up, unknown name, 13 years of age, Italy, in June of this year.
It's shocking.
the fact that unknown name, the fact that parents haven't claimed that child, that 13-year-old child. I'm not even going to talk about it too much now because I'll set off again, because that was the one that on Sunday. That was the name which just where I felt my breath stop and just had to compose myself.
It is. I mean, it's really shocking. I think, yeah, pick it up on that point of the fact that the person isn't named, you know, and perhaps that is, as you're suggesting, you know, particularly the parents didn't want to name their child, for example. Mm-hmm. And again, I mean, even in their death, they're not acknowledged. So,
yeah. I think one of the things you touched on there was the fact that so many of the people in the US were sex workers. And I know that the Sex Workers Alliance Ireland put out a press release on Trans Day of Remembrance saying that supporting trans people means supporting sex work decriminalization, which was a big focus of the weekend. And of course, that just means an element of protection for any sex workers. And there was also Abortion Rights IE also through their support behind it. And one of the things which I hadn't been aware of, because I don't seem to get as many notifications from the Irish groups that I'm a member of these days, but their Abortion Rights Campaign and Trans Writers Union were boycotting the Irish Times.
Yeah, and again, I mean, I hadn't heard an awful lot of about it myself. I believe it's kind of an ongoing situation, in that I suppose it was the Irish Times were publishing very one-sided or almost non-investigative pieces around conversion therapy and kind of things like that. So a lot of say campaigners and rights groups have come out to say, you know, they're encouraging their members to not read anything published by the Irish Times, or, you know, use their paywalls and things like that. And I think it's, you know, it's a good stand, and it hits them where it matters for a business, which is in monetary value. Mm-hmm. And it's obviously highlighting their lack of investigative journalism on the topics as well.
I find it incredulous, really, that, you know, the Irish Times, one of the biggest papers in Ireland, are being, by all accounts, uncritical on the conversion therapy articles. It's 2021.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. I mean, it's a no-brainer. I think we all inherently know right from wrong. And, you know, there isn't a question here. It's wrong. It's absolutely wrong. And that's it. I know it's great to debate, and it's great to on radio shows to have, you know, representatives from both areas. But sometimes I feel it's okay to just go, absolutely no, this isn't a right and wrong situation. You know, it's 100% wrong. It's not a gray area.
Absolutely. And as much as I don't fear the thought of debating anybody on that, it's just not, I don't want to talk to anybody who believes conversion therapy is even slightly, even 0.0001% correct. It just, no.
Now, so, I do have some good news, however. Some positive news relating to, you know, trans people, non-binary people. I was at the theatre at the weekend. Mm-hmm. First, great to be back in the theatre, and I'm happy to report it was jam-packed, which was brilliant. Jam-packed, socially distant jam-packed, I should say.
I'll do my weekly translations. A theatre is a theatre for anybody listening in the UK.
the T's and H's, this, that, these and those. Okay. So the really positive thing about that was I noticed on the bathroom doors that they had a message which read, inside you will find 4 cubicles, transgender and non-binary people are welcome.
Excellent.
And I just thought, isn't that fantastic to see that in a theater, and, you know, I mean, I feel like, you know, it's a very small, simple message, but obviously means a massive amount to so many people. And I was really happy to see that. The other thing, I think, you know, I'm obviously quite an open-minded person and try to be as inclusive as possible. But I have found over the last few weeks from chatting to you on the radio show, listening to your guests, I just feel I'm just so much more aware of different things around me. And something like that, whereas before I might have read it and maybe not taught so much. When I read it this week, I was like, okay, I really get the and understand that. And I feel my understanding in general as a person has greatly improved over the last couple of weeks. So thank you to Trans Radio and to your show as well for that.
But, you know, one of the things, I guess, I would only have become acutely aware of the bathroom situation a few years ago when in a pub in Brighton, it was highlighted by a friend. And one of the lovely things to see now is that a number of the pubs, restaurants, I was in a place for breakfast a few weeks ago where it's all gender neutral bathrooms and it's fantastic. But the other thing that shocks me is there are quite a high number of the LGBTQ venues which don't have gender neutral toilets, which to me, it's like, you know, if you want to get around, if you want to get away from anybody having issues, if you want to get around, if you want to be totally inclusive, gender neutral toilets are a really easy win. It's a very simple yes. thing to do to make all your patrons feel comfortable. It ain't difficult.
Yeah, and interesting you said that because, again, I was in the George at the weekend. And like that, the upstairs part, you'll be familiar with it. They have massive toilets and they are very much segregated.
Yeah.
Very, very much segregated, men's, women's. And the signage, that is, as far as I'm aware, that's the only signage that's on those doors. And a simple message like they had in the theatre of inside you will find X amount of cubicles, transgender and non-binary people are welcome. I mean, I think that would be a massive change and quite a simple one as well. Another thing actually just kind of related to that and the kind of use of pronouns and stuff like that. I was chatting to my friend Carol Ann this week as well. So she works for a pharmacy company here, Bristol Myers Squibb. Mm-hmm. They have, again, just a really positive kind of change that people can make in their workplace. They have a safe zone project whereby they have a space on their email to include their pronouns if people choose to do it. Mm-hmm. And a little link beside the pronouns to say why they do that or what's, you know, why it's included. And again, I think it's a nice little identifier for people and for people receiving those emails to go, I'm comfortable with that person. They understand. So again, little things like that. I haven't seen it yet where I work and, you know, maybe it's something they will bring in as well.
It's it's nice to see. That's something which really started to take off here not long before COVID and has just continued to do so. Little steps to increase inclusivity and make everybody comfortable.
Yeah, absolutely. And as we know, those little steps can add up to huge impacts.
One of the things that before we head off, one of the things that touched upon it just came back to me. I was actually really friendly with when I worked in Dublin. I worked for quite a large organisation, and I was friendly with the lady who ran the canteen. In fact, we travelled in together in the mornings. And that whole thing you said about the TH and the T and Irish people confusing. I saw this group of people and the salad bar. I saw this group of people standing giggling and there was this lovely sign which should have said and which the lovely Marshall hadn't spelt properly. It should have said, please use the tongs provided for the salads. But it actually said, please use the thongs provided. So he confused the other way and out of H in. And to this day, I'd forgotten. Thank you for reminding me of that because that was a really happy memory I'd forgotten about. Yeah. Now we won't be speaking to you next week because next week is our special program on 40 years of HIV/AIDS and 40 years since yep. first reported cases. So then by the time we're going to be speaking to you again, we're going to be a week into December, and no doubt your Christmas party, you will be back to turning up for the opening of an envelope.
We will be back to Christmas festivities and you might even get over your very recent and unacceptable phobia of Mariah Carey and her All I Want for Christmas. So you should be in the festive mood by then.
You had to ruin my mood this evening, didn't you?
One does one's best.
Rory, thank you so much for joining us and I look forward to talking to you in a fortnight.
Always a pleasure, Kevin. Talk to you soon.
Take care. Bye.
Oh, I love this.
We continue in moments.
This is good.
Yes, yes.
You're locked to Trans Radio UK. Trans Radio, supporting mermaids. Family and individual support for gender diverse and transgender children. For information, go to www.mermaidsuk.org.uk.
Do you need someone to talk to?
feel you have no one that will listen.
It doesn't have to be that way.
Well, everybody hurts, but sometimes everybody cries. Everybody hurts.
Truck listens, because everyone needs to talk sometime.
Call 0800 009 6640 between 8am and 2am. Truck listens, because everybody needs to talk sometime.
Did you know we receive no funding here at Trans Radio UK? To keep us on air and growing, we rely on donations. To donate, please head to www.transradiouk.com and click the link. A regular payment of £20 will see you become a partner of Truck. Other options are available. Email info@transradiouk.com for details. A big thank you from all the team here at Trans Radio UK.
Trans Radio UK is on.
Right now.
Across the UK and beyond. Now. More of the music you love.
What's more?
Trans Radio UK.
And now, it's time for the nation's favourite scouse wife, your friend and mine. It is, of course, the only Ruffles, and I'm going to find out what is ruffling her feathers this week. Good evening, Ruffles.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm all right, yeah, you?
Not too bad. How were the feet? You were in heels non-stop last week.
Oh, yeah. Full on. Last weekend was a really, really good weekend, actually. Really great audiences, but yeah, a lot of time in heels. And when you're 7 foot like I am, it tends to take its toll. So the tattoos are just starting to stop burning now. I've had them in some cold water and things, so they're all right.
Yeah, you've been all across Brighton, London. You've been a busy queen over the last week.
Yeah, been good though, which has brought me to, I've had a lot of time to scour the social medias and things and find out what's ruffled my feathers this week. So the Brit Awards, not that they've ruffled my feathers, but as of next year, they've decided to go gender neutral with their awards, which is great. So they're no longer going to have best male and best female and all this sort of stuff. They're just going to have best artist categories, which I think is fantastic.
Absolutely.
What's ruffling my feathers is the backlash that they're getting. Not just off, I mean, the general public have been vile about it. Some of them have been awful. But off actual celebrities, there's a lot of people. I'm not going to name any names because they may change their mind or apologise and all this sort of thing, which they should. But yeah. Some really, really influential artists out there are saying some absolutely horrid, horrid things. The biggest one that I found is people saying that it's going to affect women more than anyone else, saying that it's going to become a male-dominated industry again, and all that sort of caper. Now, through delving into this a little bit more, I noticed and I found that the MTV Music Awards made this decision back in 2017. And since then, there is a list online, which I can't find. I was reading it last night. It's been such a mixed bag of people who identify as male and female who've won this category. So it hasn't really affected anyone.
One of the things that makes me laugh, some of the backlash I've seen online is, oh, this is the end of the Brits. It's never going to be the same again. They've ruined the Brits. Uh-huh. Well, hello, the Grammys.
Correct.
Which don't have gender-specific awards.
Nope.
It hasn't done any harm to anybody. And actually, the mix of winners is a good split of genders. So, we're living in a world where it's... You take a look at someone as talented, and as I think there's three Brit Awards that Sam Smith has won, but effectively, for the last 2 years, since they came out as non-binary... Sam hasn't been able to be nominated for an award, which is just massively unfair.
Uh-huh. Yeah, absolutely. No, especially, as you say, Sam Smith, they have been quite prolific actually in social media and in the media, stating that this is something that they want for the awards, something they believe in, or something they believe should be right. Because there was another someone on here, some guy said that if they were to start, I think he's some music executive or something, I can't remember his name. But he said if we were to start these awards all over again as today, as a new award ceremony, mm-hmm. this is the way it would have to happen. So I don't really see. The thing that's getting to me is, out of all of this, I'm so glad it's happened, but it's these celebrities that are kicking off.
Mm.
And it's like, oh, get a life. The money you've got and the amount of time, you've probably got more awards on your shelf than you know what to do with and probably don't dust them.
Yeah.
just think, shut up. Let someone, do you know what I mean? If it makes other people happy and it makes it more inclusive, just roll with it.
Absolutely. And, you know, one of the really valid points that Juno raised earlier on the programme this evening was that all of this ridiculous noise, which, of course, we're just feeding into now by discussing it as well, but all of this ridiculous noise is taken away from the media are focusing on things like this. And it's taken away from the key messages and the really important facts, like the fact that 375 trans people, predominantly of colour, have been murdered over the last year.
That we know of.
Exactly. And, you know, the media being so tied up and asking for celebrities' comments on this kind of drivel, something as inconsequential as an award ceremony, is taken away from all the attention. This has got way more coverage over the last couple of days, which, again, we're just feeding into, but I think it's important to talk about. But this has got way more coverage than Transgender Day of Remembrance did last Sunday.
I know, which was really, really annoying, actually, and really got to me because on last Sunday, I performed at a venue here in Brighton. Well, last weekend I did loads. But in every venue I performed, I sang a certain song, which you can see on YouTube and on our website. I'm sure Kevin will fill you in about that later on. But the song means so much to me and apparently my audiences because it made, it touched a lot of people, it got to them. And the speech that I connected to that song was that when we stand shoulder to shoulder together, when we stand shoulder to shoulder together, we stand stronger.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that I stand with our communities and our trans brothers and sisters. And leading up to all of that and how I hope I made people feel and how it came across to people, to see that it was just, there was nothing. I mean, there was only people that my friends that I knew that maybe shared a picture on Facebook or had something to say about it, but the media itself, I was really, really let down by, actually, I'll be honest, and the platforms that the media have got should have been blowing up on Sunday, but it was kind of a non-star, it was a bit of a non-deal, and it was really sad.
Absolutely. In the general media, of course, a lot of the LGBTQ press had covered it and the Facebook pages had covered it. But as you say, the general press, and I mean, I was at one of those shows that you're talking about on Saturday night, where there was a trans friend of ours who started to weep. And it's, you know, the general press doesn't cover any of that. But yet, you know, the fact that the Brits may have awards suddenly front pages of all the tabloids and it's pretty bonkers. I can see why that has ruffled your feathers this week.
I don't get it, just because there's some, and do you know what the funniest thing is, if you look on social media and you look on into the medias and all that, who are the people that are kicking off? The people that it doesn't affect.
Absolutely.
It's not the trans people. I don't know whether I'm allowed to say a certain thing that I was about to say. It's not swearing, but there's a certain generation that need to stop poking the nose in everyone else's business and let us, if we've got a fight to have, we'll have our fight. Thank you very much. We don't need you sticking it in the media for us.
Absolutely. And we'll miss you next week. There is, of course, no ruffing your feathers next week when we have our World AIDS Day special.
No one told me that.
Well, you can talk about that the following week. That can be what ruffled your feathers.
Oh, I'm sure we've got a lot to talk about the week after that, I promise you. With World AIDS Day coming up, you believe you me, there'll be someone, some little horror on social media somewhere who'll grab my attention who I won't let go of. I'll have him in my talons.
Well, just don't do anything you regret. We'd like you here in a fortnight. Ruffles, thank you so much for joining me this evening.
No probs. Thank you very much. I'll see you soon.
See you soon. Bye. That's it for this week. We will be back, of course, next week. And it's a very special show next week. Next Wednesday is, of course, World AIDS Day, and the show is going to be dedicated to that very topic. It's 40 years since those first reported cases of HIV and AIDS, so we wanted to do something special to mark that. We have some incredible guests lined up, and I hope you can join me next week for what is going to be a very special and, I suspect, very touching show. And until then, have a wonderful week, and I look forward to talking to you next week. Night.
Love this.
We continue in moments.
This is good.
Yes, yes.
You're locked to Trans Radio UK.
Tea and Coffee are a global network providing alcohol-free safe spaces through face-to-face and online platforms. All of our events are held in safe, accessible and alcohol-free environments, allowing our members to relax and really connect with one another. To become part of one of the fastest growing global networks for trans and gender diverse people, simply visit tncoffeelgbt.com. That's the letter tncoffeelgbt.com. At Tea and Coffee, we're supporting you to be you.
Many website owners don't like their website hosting company or support provider, but are too scared to move to someone else in case they lose their site or it affects their business. Based in Telford, at Purple Prince Media, we will move your website to us free of charge with the best support possible. And if you're looking to start up a business, we're also here to design and build your website from the ground up with unbeatable prices on web hosting and dedicated servers. We're also certified Magento developers, which is the world's biggest e-commerce platform. So, rest assured, your online business is just a click away. Drop us an email on hello@purpleprince.co.uk. Or visit purpleprince.co.uk to get started. Purple Prince Media, the local website company.
International Trans Lifestyle Magazine, available in print and digital. Support group and events, information, friendship and support. Transliving.co.uk. Did you know you can advertise with us for less than £1 a day? Call 0207 856 0584 or email sales@transradiouk.com.
For the community, by the community, Trans Radio UK.
Trans Radio UK is on
right now.
Across the UK and beyond. Now. Now. More of the music you love.
Once more.
Trans Radio UK.